Minu nimi on Neeme Järvi. Ma olen dirigent. Juhatan ja õpetan noori dirigeerima.
Although my guest today needs no introduction in the musical world, ubiquitous even well into his 80s with orchestras and his prolific recordings, our Living the Classical Life trip to visit him deserves special mention. We're traveling to the seaside resort city of Pärnu, located in Estonia on the Baltic Sea and popular in the region as a holiday destination with its many beaches, restaurants, and hotels. With its distinctive tree-lined streets and old wooden architecture, the city was the summer home to violinist David Oistrakh, who gathered his musician friends to play together in his green dacha. In this spirit, the Järvi family created the Pärnu Music Festival as an extension of their longtime connection with a truly special place. Today's episode is made possible in part by you, our viewers, and we thank you for watching the show. Mr. Järvi, thank you so much for joining me here on the show. It's a delight to have you. So I'm still recovering from the concert that we heard last night of your son, Kristjan, in an experience that I've never had before in the concert hall. The audience was clapping, we had lights, we had the type of music that is sustained across 2 hours performed from memory. When you were growing up as a music student, could you picture that your musical family would go in such a direction as this?
I think it is a natural development things, because our family is fanatics. I was a very big fanatic from where I was born. Already 3 years old, I played a xylophone in the radio, you see. A soloist, not in the orchestra, but a soloist playing piece for my brother's accompaniment. And since that time, I'm fanatically, because my mother, my parents, give me injection. They are both haircutters. They know nothing to do with music. But they knew about what's important young people's life, and they made a choice what we're going to music. And we're going to have to practice all life with this music. Whatever, practice, but no football. 2 hours you are practicing in piano until you go to the football. No boys sit outside, oh, come on, why, you know, it is the football. That means it is a direction, it starts from childhood time. In our children, all three children, ours, together with my wife, we had, and we made this direction happen. But then developed this vision, future. Everybody find his own way. My three children and our three children, they are all different, but we get this fanatism from somewhere. I don't know exactly who was that, but our home was always Mozart. From morning to evening, 46, well, I was a great record buyer and looking repertoire and new things also, and the recordings, what I had, what was possibilities, were possibilities I bought, and Mozart was all the time. And Kristjan was small boy when he was just didn't speak yet. And of course he heard all every day Mozart symphony. Mozart, we had a loudspeakers, and he went once, where was Kristjan? He went to show where the loudspeakers are, and he trying to find there where is the Mozart. And loudspeaker hit him, and it came to the kitchen. Ah, the first word what he said in his life was, Mozart! The Mozart is doing things his own way, but I think it is so interesting and so much creating new things in music. He's a very good conductor. He has had many jobs as a classical conductor, but he's doing very good jazz. He's doing an absolute ensemble in New York. Then he's doing, I said, why are you doing this jazz? Why are you spending time for this? Father, is this the future? It is so important. Yes, it's important, but you need to conduct, you know, Brahms and Beethoven and all this. I'm doing this thing, but I need this also. And now what is doing this concert, which I heard yesterday, but I heard it before also, because I heard this orchestra playing full Tchaikovsky ballet, 45 minutes, hour and 45 minutes, Tchaikovsky ballet, Swan Lake, by heart. Hmm. That I don't understand. How is possible all these second and third trombones and all the percussion services know exactly to play, and all without music, without stands, staying, and everybody enjoying, and a special version made by Kristjan Järvi, this Tchaikovsky music, he's just conducting and having joy, and everybody enjoying also. How is possible to inject people and persuade them to do that? I don't understand.
This question of enjoying, I noticed, so I witnessed your conducting of the opening concert here at the Pärnu Festival. It seemed like you were having fun. Did you always feel like you had the space to have fun?
Fun is a profession. Not only you must exactly know what to do, what you're doing. You're not waving hands. You have to already develop your vision, who you are, and what you want from this life. First, great big life and love to the music, but how we can make that music great music making, but that's a question. So you need a technique, you need a knowledge about, you have a plan exactly what to do, you have to plan your life like this, you have a dodge, you must exactly know what I need actually now to do in this time of my life. He's composing now. Composer, suddenly. Yesterday I see Philip Glass. I don't know, didn't really realize who was Philip Glass, what was a Kristjan Järvi piece. Mm-hmm. He mixed the Philip Glass and Kristjan Järvi piece. And it was so such a wonderful collaboration with the two composers. And also it is some kind of new style. If we're talking about Arvo Pärt music, who is just kind of very simple, but sounds like little Bach, neoclassical, little bit like from here, from there, short pieces. You call it like minimalism. It's not maximalism, it's minimalism. Mm-hmm. Yes, you know. He's doing the same thing, but completely different way. He got his harmonies, he's repeating like Philip Glass, he said, start the harmony, some kind of choral comes, orchestration, you know, and then it turns to Philip Glass suddenly, and suddenly comes a rhythm Philip Glass, and actually it's not a Philip Glass original piece, it's his music for piano. But he asks his good friend Charles Coleman, orchestrate that. Yeah. Fantastically done. Mm-hmm. This orchestrated, again, who is making the Kristjan asked Charles to do that one. Mm-hmm. But their friendship. Their friendship as the musicians. Let's do that one. Let's do that one. Let's try that one.
I want to ask you about Mravinsky, because he struck me as a extremely impressive and serious guy. When I look at his photos, I'm almost a little bit intimidated. What was it like to work with who I regard to be a very serious man?
Exactly? Ask once more.
Yes, I'm trying to explore the idea of taking our musical life very seriously.
Yeah.
It seemed like Mravinsky was
a very serious
man.
Oh, Mravinsky you're talking about. Yes, I understand. So, yes, people are different. And there is, as much as I've seen, some people have no talent to do everything. Some lot of people trying doesn't work. Some have a lot of ideas, not possibilities. Then you have, but if you have these possibilities, then do it. Mravinsky didn't use that one. He, one major thing, which he did, he had to create orchestra, best orchestra in the world, let's say. He must say, I do it in Tchaikovsky Fifth Symphony, do six rehearsals, and every time he came, he started to do again his own orchestra, six rehearsals for the same piece. It's headache for musicians. But it is a creation of quality. Creation of quality maximum. Every millimeter, every centimeter is important. No, it's not like that. No, it's like this. You see, is that an enjoyable thing? For him, it was an enjoyable thing, only. Like, let's say, another example, Karajan, conducting all Beethoven symphonies and closing his eyes. You have seen this end.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
What actually, I as musician, sitting orchestra, I like to see what Rostropovich playing Don Quixote and want to see what Karajan, let's collaborate, let's make you do this. Karajan doesn't look to him, no deal. It's just that me, nothing else existing in this world. This is also wrong. There are a lot of things, but ideas comes, and somewhere somebody wants to create something strange. Everything had to be logical. Everything had to be full of knowledge, and as much you have possibilities in your hands, try to do everything way you really creating something. I'm not doing it for myself. I'm doing it for my orchestra because they are good, and I do this music because the audience have to be happy what I'm doing. That's the triangle, have to be always in your mind. And your Auftakt, it is your eyes, your hands, your exactness. You're changing all the time. If you are a mechanic, you can make something, but not very successful. Almost. So my two pedagogues was like this. Nikolai Rabinovich, when I studied in Leningrad Conservatory, 1955 to 1960. One was this kind of happy man, you know. Make tongue, happy man. You know, everything was wrong. Rabinsky was like, Both are good, but here's no life. Here's life. Well, that's better, version, I think. And I have to go to the young people orchestra now, 90 people here, and teaching conductors how to do Viennese waltz, how to do Vienna, how to do it, how to play the waltz. Bum, 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 bum. Boring. You have to be the bum, 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 bum. You can't explain that exactly how, but there you have your elbow, there you have a wrist, and you have a breath. How you do it? Look, papa. No, it's not papa. Bowings. You must know bowings, strings. How strings taking music? How is possible to get the best result? Young people, not only conductors, which I am teaching, always a sitting orchestra must learn all this from the conductor who knows about everything about all these details in music.
So you've conducted all around the world. I'm curious to know what it feels like to be back here in Estonia, here at the Pärnu Festival, where you've had festivals for 50 years now.
50 years, yes. We started that with David Oistra, who was here, and Rzeszwinski was here, Rzeszupowicz, and all these people came here and make music. But I have known where I was quite good young conductor, quite. That people knew me in the Soviet Union. I was not allowed to travel much around because it was a closed country, Estonia. But a part of one of the republics, so-called. So it actually was occupied country for 50 years. So, but we did still our music in as great as possible. And I was conducting a lot of Moscow and Leningrad orchestras, big orchestras. After ending my study in Leningrad, already people knew me. I was a lot of concerts in Moscow, in Riga, and I don't know, different, Petersburg, Leningrad, and big orchestras, and I developed my art, my conducting things, and my name was quite. And then when I asked to conduct Metropolitan Opera in 1979, then I went to conduct Onegin Metropolitan Opera. Only Estonian who came to this area to be, and then already people knew me there, because I went before Leningrad and Moscow and different orchestras to conduct as a second conductor with Mravinsky, with Rzeszwinski, was a very great conductor, was my very good friend. And with Orchestra we went to the London, and Gilles was my soloist all the time, Emil Gilles. Did it all Mozart concerto or Beethoven concertos in many places. And then life develops that way. And finally went to Estonia. And it was a place where we studied with this Pärnu festival. Here's a beautiful nature. Here was no concert hall. I did everything to build here a concert hall. Now it's concert hall, it's built. It's not very big hall, a big hall, but its city is not also not big. But people want to come here because we're making great music here. Symphony music, Paavo doing wonderful festival orchestra, created orchestra, all world, Berlin Philharmonic members, for every his orchestra come to play here. They're just waiting them to come here in every summer. So, and in a short time after, and students, conducting students, they are just eager to come here. There were three wonderful pedagogues, four wonderful pedagogues teaching. And also these people who coming to the orchestra, play with Paavo, they are also teaching our Estonian young students. They're getting all the time good knowledge about great music worldwide.
We were speaking yesterday with Paavo, and I asked him if feeling like an Estonian musician or having an Estonian identity is important to him as a musician. His answer was yes, for several reasons. Is it important for you to feel like you are representing an Estonian musical tradition?
Absolutely, because we are so small piece of water in the world ocean. We need a little bit of the world, and tell them we are only something in this world. And we are, because we have wonderful, one of the best composer now, contemporary artist, Per Arvo Pärt, you see. It's built, it, you know, have you been in Arvo Pärt's center?
The center, yes.
No, it's in the forest, you know, but it's just kind of attention to the people. I think it is a wonderful thing. And the world knows about Estonia. We have wonderful composers, Edward Tubin and the older generation, and a lot of tour and a lot of wonderful. Yes, a new record came out, which had first performed with the festival orchestra here, and comes out today. New recording of power performances of this city from this Pärnu festival. So, interesting, actually. It's beautiful nature. Estonia has a very special nature. We have sea, we have islands, we have 200 islands here. Okay. Yeah, we see them from the window, even some of them. All right, and then traditions. Traditions have a certain, what is actually the Estonia is part of different kind of national heritage year. It was a complete 200 Russia. Then it was the Soviet Union. Before it was 500 years or 700 years Germany. We are actually very Germanic people here. And there were 300 years was Sweden among the German time. Around was a German thing, the Estonians was only working in the fields only, nobody. And then we're starting to sing. Now with 33,000, tradition goes, festival goes on, or you know, at the feast, more feast than festival. Feast, special building in Tallinn, where we're singing every 5 years, 33,000 and 100,000 people, patriotic undertaking, patriotic. And they're all speaking Estonian language now. We have to develop that today. All our recognition in the world comes through the culture, especially from music. Because the music is a second language which almost all world understands.
Did you usually try to program Estonian music on your programs around the world?
Quite. All American orchestras have been by mine conducting Estonian work.
And what was the reception to this music, say, for example, in Detroit, when you played Estonian
very
music?
Very much. Very, very interesting, because I'm not too much them. I'm not playing this huge symphonies, which is destroying people's mood. but I try to together. I want to do something which people like, and I know which I like that people like, and which I like to do, I have to persuade people like them. So I have to know those people, those pieces. And in Detroit, we develop fantastic things. Also, Estonia have wonderful also encores, small things, beautiful things, marches and all these things. I started to play encores. American orchestra is low as no encores. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. No encores, you know.
Right.
It's not a good thing, you know. I go to the Chicago, encore. No, we're not playing encores.
Oh.
Stupid.
The unions.
It's not a good thing. That and that was before I was chairman conductor, was chief conductor. He played every day and every concert was Bruckner. Of course, it was empty halls. But I started to know, why is empty hall? Why I had to do something. I played popular pieces, among them world music, different kind of world music, but encores, I started encores. And people get so much kind of injection for these encores. They came to the concert. Management said, we can't do any more two concerts per week, with the three concerts. Oh, next year we did only four concerts. And it was all four concerts was full of audience. Not because I played Estonian musical or Shostakovich symphony. What's Järvi going to play as an encore? And it was a revelation all the time, the encore. It was completely that fantastic thing, the encores in music, because people, different quality of these people comes to the concert. Mm. One like this, one like this, one like this, one. But Star of Stripe Forever, everybody likes.
Yeah.
You know, that's or some kind of music, which is there is a certain piece in a symphonic music which you can just enjoy and you're coming out a winner.
I'm very curious to know your feeling from your experience about the influence between the conductor and the orchestra. So you were 22 years at Göteborg, you were 15 years in Detroit. Did you feel in this time that you witnessed the orchestra change under your hands?
Absolutely, absolutely. I don't really, when Detroit orchestra playing, it is a, you know, Detroit was the second great city in America. It was a great history of this orchestra. Even the Detroit was for Osif Gabrilovich, the conductor, was building a concert hall in 4 months and 20 days. Mm. I can be your conductor, but build me a concert hall. They did. But this was Detroit, the time, 1920s. That means if you're taking your job, you must come to succeed and get to the best from them. But how? You had a material, must to have a personality who going to draw that, how to try the orchestra playing like this or doing like this, and mutual understanding between conductor and orchestra and management. And Mr. Davidson, Will Davidson, who owner of Detroit Pistons, also important.
Really?
I had to go to Pistons six times a year, and I had this huge noise. 10,000 people have a game, and I asked him to come to the Shostakovich. He came, of course. And then I said, you like Shostakovich, of course, but I am not coming to their concert because I... Yeah. But he supports our orchestra. American, we need the support. Our government doesn't do nothing for it. Every country, every state to doing their own. Mm-hmm. Not only state, but every city helps with sponsoring. You have to work for everything. But management and mutual understanding to planning, yearly plan and repertoire and conductor's technical ability and love to the music. He had to give this very simple way all his wishes to your orchestra, and if it works, then you get good results. I have quite a lot of recording done, and some of them I like very much. Of course, I like more open performances still lively performance. But then I tried also to do recordings as lively performance, like it is. It breathes. It is. You see something go on. This is here. Otherwise, it's you listen. Oh, clean, nice, and nothing happened. Music making is a very, very special thing. You must really make music. You like, love it, and everybody likes it. Your performance. That's what we're doing.
What's your relationship to your audience? Are you aware of your audience when you're performing? Are you performing to them? Do you need your audience for your best performance?
Oh, yes, very much, because still the triangle, my orchestra, me, and audience, it's kind of triangle all the time. When you're performing, this is for you, for audience, because if I see the happy faces in audience and all this reaction, or even when I can out, when I come out, I see, oh, they just can't wait when I have nothing to do with music. That's going to be a big difference when it just is going to uninteresting claps. I see it, this audience is quite a boring one. I had to do something. Yeah, this is a very important thing. Mm-hmm.
Do you ever get surprised at the feedback that you get from your audience? Sometimes I hear of people who say that one performance changed their life. Did that ever happen with one of your audience members, that they were just completely moved, that their life changed direction?
Yeah, during their life have been thousand performances, and only certain of them you probably can remember. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it's a kind of job. For me, myself, it's always happy moment. But of course, when you're repeating, I don't like very much to repeat same repertoire four times per week. It is a typical American way, or even European way, some orchestra playing the symphony. Then what I'm doing, I trying to enjoy myself, my craft, do every time and every evening differently, performances. You have to be spontaneity, orchestra, and orchestra need that also. Orchestra need very much. Audience, in this case, is my audience is orchestra. I'm playing with orchestra. I'm not beating bars and trying to get the same result what I did yesterday. I always have a different performances during these three performances. And that's my audience, then I don't have audience. And then I feel also I had to play something also with audience. How they're changing. They're changing, and you feel with your back they're changing. Mm. Not because it's and if in some kind of great moment came in orchestra, I feel it gets there, it gets to the audience. It is there. Then I'm happy. Then I'm very happy. And that it is also ability to the conductor.
What does it take to be an effective leader as a conductor? And did you always feel like you had these qualities?
Main thing is it's not to be boring with the same repertoire. Hmm. With your same repertoire comes again doing the same pieces over and over again. You have to change your repertoire. The variety of repertoire is important. And music of different nationalities. Because every nationality have a lot of good music and great music. But you stay some kind of area all the time. Oh, I'm good for Russian music. Oh, I am very good for Brahms. And doing Brahms. Oh, I'm just Bruckner conductor. Doing Bruckner all the time. No, I'm good for everything. And I like to have be good for everything. That's what conductor have to mind. He must to change his style. Czech music, what a great thing, Czech. Hungarian music, fantastic. Romanian music, you're doing this. whatever Estonian music you're doing, you know, Russian music you're doing, actually, American music. I did a lot of many recordings of American music, which you can, big book of American music, written great composer, wonderful composer. We know only three of them, or four, or five.
You mentioned earlier that you had an influence on the orchestras that you conducted. Did they have an influence on you and your development?
Yeah, when I see somebody really good one, then we're going to play together all evening. Look what I did. He prizes that because I see it, they understand we are in the same boat together and doing the same thing, and we love what we're doing. Not much orchestra players love what we're doing because they're all different, and many of them quite a formalists who are doing formal way of playing these notes. Then I try to get to him and listen, let's make together things happen.
So if you've witnessed the musical life across so many decades, I'm assuming that you feel that the musical world, the audiences, the music, the programming has changed. When you're teaching conducting students today, is your approach and what you advise them, is it towards a different musical world? Are these musical aims staying the same?
No, we never same. We're always changing things. Composer wrote this kind of quite an unprofessional saying, and looking at it, composer wrote like this, composer didn't wrote like, composer wrote just a piece and the notes and we interpreters have to discover what actually the style or temp is and whatever there is and make a big change. It's always the kind of feel you started a piece like scratch, Beethoven symphony. Mm-hmm. The Beethoven symphony scratch, and Pavo did it. Pavo did a completely different Beethoven set. And it was appreciated, not the same what Karajan did, what whoever other every time, but my Beethoven. How we know? But Pavo made the Deutsche Kammerphilharmonie very special case of reading Beethoven symphonies or other things, because he has own view on things. Every conductor has their own view on things. No, never repeat, and nobody must to hear somebody recording and copy it. It's absolutely wrong. You have to always have your own ideas. And if it's very good performances, then I'm happy to copy. But I can't very little those. Because let's say, if we see people complete happy what they're doing and the orchestra answering like this, some Kleiber performances like this, or some really the same Johann Strauss evenings, how people love that and how orchestra responds. Completely different, the other conductor.
So you talked about listening to recordings. If you listen to your recordings from the very early days, do you feel like your style has changed? Have you become deeper?
Yeah, absolutely. This what I have done, what kind of quality I had actually 30 years old or 20 years old or I had such quality, and of course we already had this discussion about technique and ideas and phrasing and whatever, there are the bowings and whatever. But practically, now I can mold with my hands things, and my mind is very much ready to prepare things better, not just to beat bars. But prepare the piece for performances this way, persuasive way to the musician, and I already know what I want to do, and my hand already goes some three bars ahead what actually comes. And actually it comes like this, because it's your preparation for the performances is always had to be already planned before. Or sometimes you're doing it spontaneously. Sometimes you are spontaneous, it's kind of, okay, I'm doing like this now. And then orchestra already believes and trusts you, because our relationship, whatever you're doing, you can stop the piece, middle of the piece, and I'm not conducting, they're not playing. So then that means the play with, between conductor and the orchestra playing, it is some kind of wonderful toy to each other. Mm-hmm.
Did you always feel like the world of stage was a comfortable one for you? Were you feeling well before performances, and then when you walked out onto stage, it felt natural?
I got always some example recordings of every concert, concert recordings, and many of them I love, because there's a concert recordings and there's going something on, expression, how orchestra making phrasing. What is my phrasing? I come from here, point to there. Not da 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 da. All those. That's you had to embrace or all these things somewhere to make it one big good thing. You know, not just kind of piece by piece. That means you're very nice to have a collaboration with soloists. When you sing, conductor has to also feel like you are part of soloists, not accompanying. I don't like the word soloist accompaniator. No, I am part of this piece and I conduct you and making phrasing and the singer and help breathe with him and this one and slow down here and look to each other. Ah, that was a good one. Yes, let's see. That was a collaboration. Collaboration always needed between the artists.
And of course, being here at the Pärnu Festival, I'm meeting your family, and I'm hearing the feedback of all of your musicians about your family. A theme that I'm hearing emerging is that also included in this great family is your remarkable wife. What is her role in
my
your
wife,
picture?
My wife is a wife of 60 years. And one same wife all the time, and very happy about that, because we have that's why we have a good family. And she's a leading person for everything, trying to direct everything in the right direction. Otherwise, we can get lost in this world. And also, we have to emigrate from Estonia to America. And came back from there, and were citizen of two countries, you know, and Americans, and very happy about that. But
how did you meet?
Made much wider our view on things, and much way our how world to all world is. It's our hands some way, and our homes are here or there, and children, because that children are in some in Europe and in America and in Scandinavia busy, and the music is like this. It's all organized, and of course the wife have a very great role of this. And his main job to direct and lovable relationship. This is very important thing.
How did you meet, and was it through music?
Because we studied in Leningrad conservatory in Leningrad. She was not musician, but was different librarian books and all this, very intelligent person, and doing noise a lot of things. Different institution. I was in conservatory, and she was in another university. So just like me, usually people meeting, and it was happy meeting. And the happiness continues.
So this show is about the musical life. What do you advise young people in order to live their best musical life?
To learn their craft more properly. And quite important, very seriously think about it before they go starting to do something. Because if you're doing, you're not thinking. First you have to think and then to do. How to perform, how to conduct even this piece. Everybody must understand music must be written for everyone in the world. And you talk about the audience. Orchestra must like it, and audience must like it. That's why you must be a good composer. Composer who tells his music, I'm composer, really. I'm doing something because I'm doing it for you, not only for my personal, individual, egoistic interest. Yes, that's why I'm doing like this, complicated. Nobody understand. Conductor doesn't understand. Nobody understand. And that this kind of feeling has to be forgotten. Have to be more technical preparation. Intonation, pay attention for intonation. Intonation always falls. Quality of performances and beauty and enjoyable music making. That's why we're living in this world.
Maestro Järvi, thank you so much for joining. Thanks for this conversation. Thanks for everything that you've brought to the musical world, and I wish you many more years of musical discoveries. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Have to go to
airplane
mode. Airplane mode. Done.
Voilà.